In the very center of the Chernobyl explosion zone stands a gigantic wall around the power plant. Made of a special isolation mixture, it's nearly 2 miles long and 30 meters or 100 feet tall. But no one can see it, because it's underground. This is a story of one of the most unusual engineering projects in Chernobyl. In previous episodes, we explored the massive efforts that were made in 1986 to fight the consequences of the Chernobyl disaster. If you haven't seen them yet, here is the core idea. Nearly 90,000 people built the sarcophagus, the isolation structure above the reactor. Dozens of thousands more worked to clean up the surrounding lands of what had been brought there by the winds. However, if you know that a comparable effort was undertaken to protect the water. During the summer of 1986, over 100 filtration dams and silt traps were built along the Pripyat River basin. Many irrigation channels were blocked or rerouted, and thousands of tons of sorbents were added to the water. All this to stop radionuclides from reaching the Kyiv reservoir, the Dnieper, and the Black Sea. And yet, the biggest concern was the power plant site itself, which received the main impact. Rains would help carry radioactive materials into the underground water and from there into the rivers. However, a situation of this scale had never been seen before, so no one knew for sure how severe the impact might be. And so, as a precaution, a powerful barrier had to be created, and this is how the invisible wall came to be. The plan was to dig a narrow vertical ditch, no wider than 1 meter or 3 feet, but deep enough to cut through several layers of sand and reach the clay below. Then it had to be filled with a compressed mixture of bentonite clay and cement, creating a barrier that water couldn't pass through. This technology is called diaphragm wall, and it is often used in the construction of survey stations. But here it had to be applied in extreme conditions and on an unimaginable scale. The wall was to surround the entire power plant site, more than 30 kilometers or 18 miles. And its depths ranged from 30 to 60 meters, roughly equivalent to a large apartment block. Multiple research institutes joined forces to find the optimal projects, so hundreds of drilling machines appeared across the zone. And point by point, scientists collected geological data, producing maps like this one. Every red line here represents a geological cross-section, each followed by highly detailed explanation. And by combining this with samples obtained from the boreholes, it was concluded that it would be sufficient to build a much shorter, 8-kilometer wall. This task was assigned to the Association Gidrospets project led by Nikolai Dmitriev. He sent 1,400 of his engineers to the zone and then there himself. Mikhail Rosin, the head engineer of Gidrospets project, recalled that the task looked really challenging, but exactly this made it really interesting for them. Yet, there was a problem. Creating such a vertical ditch is possible only using special machines. They carefully remove soil layer by layer, immediately injecting a circulating bentonite slurry into freshly exposed walls. This liquid mixture exerted pressure, keeping the trench sides vertical and preventing collapse. Gidrospets project had such machines called SVD-500, but not enough of them. The government responded, if we don't have what we need, well, we'll just buy abroad. However, many companies that were contacted refused to help, except one, the Italian Casa Grande. For $23 million, they agreed to supply 12 grub excavators and hydraulic milling machines. They also suggested sending their experts to the Chernobyl zone to assemble and maintain them. But eventually they were not allowed to do this because of a heavy regime of secrecy. And instead, two engineers from Hydrospets project went to Italy to learn all the nuances. According to this report, already on June 17 the work started. The first 5 meters of the concrete wall in the ground have been completed. The excavation was carried out of the depths of 30 meters using the domestic SVD-500 machine. And since then, every week, one more Soviet and one more Italian units were launched. At one point, 11 machines operated simultaneously, 24 hours per day. Needless to say, such intensity for this type of construction had never been seen before. Of course, not everything went well. For example, occasionally they hit a pipe or a cable. This is because part of the documentation regarding their exact location was lost in a post-disaster mess. One of the Casa Grande excavators appeared to have a factory malfunction, so it had to be brought to Kiev for repair by Italian supervisors and then returned back to the zone. Soviet machines often had problems due to their low quality. Actually, I found a descriptive paragraph in this report stating: "The main cause of SVD-500 machine's downtime was a malfunction of its electrical system. The wiring was installed carelessly, the winch motor was faulty, and the several components didn't meet the required standards. But despite all the problems, construction advanced very well. And 4 months later, by October 1986, they had built 2.8 kilometers of the complete wall. As research continued, it was decided that this was sufficient, and the work on the wall construction stopped. On its inner side, a set of drainage valves were created which handled the places where the wall had openings. But that wasn't all. The cooling pond of the power plant was an artificial reservoir with a water level much higher than natural. So, to avoid its influence on the wall and the river, a system of 350 dewatering and drainage drills was created. Around the power plant, numerous monitoring valves were established to track groundwater contamination. And if you have been to the Chernobyl zone, you might have seen some of them yourself. For example, near the famous Riverside Cafe in the city of Pripyat. And that very place has another secret connected to our story. The thing is, when you approach the cafe, you have to pass this little hill. It's not really visible because of bushes and trees, but it is actually not a hill at all, but a nearly 2 km dam that protects the city along its waterfront. This is one of the elements of that gigantic hydrotechnical system we mentioned at the beginning. And this system was about to withstand a crash test. Because according to meteorologists, a massive snowfall was expected in the winter of 1987. That forecast appeared to be correct. For example, this is what the city of Pripyat looked like that winter. And as you can imagine, in spring, this was expected to create a massive flood. However, the system of walls, dams and traps withstood it just perfectly. And moreover, the data obtained during the floods proved that the migration of radionuclides with water was significantly less intense than it was expected. In other words, this vast system of engineering facilities, including the underground wall, was very much redundant. But in that situation, the stakes were really too high and no one could take any chances. And so the engineers gave their absolute best. But what happened to those Casa Grande machines? Well, let me share with you a memory from my childhood. One day in the early 90s, we were walking with my father in the center of Kiev when we passed a subway construction site. I was always fascinated by those because, as you can imagine, there was always some interesting machinery. But this time, something unusual was working. My father told me that they were building some sort of wall in the ground. And only years later, I discovered from my books that those were exactly the Casa Grande machines that had previously built the Chernobyl invisible wall. Thanks to their design, they were successfully decontaminated and later used for various projects, such as the construction of the Kiev subway. And decades later, after that walk, I passed by that very metro station I had once seen as a child. I was on my way to the administration of the Chernobyl zone, which is based in the building right next to it. What a beautiful circle history has made, isn't it? If you made it this far, thank you for watching. As always, you can find interesting bonus reading for this episode on our Patreon page, along with other Chernobyl insights from us. And we'll see you in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.